Amen. Good to see everybody. Let's give the Lord a great big hand. All righty. It's so good to see everybody and hope that you are enjoying this at home. We do have many prayer requests. I've actually got a few that was calling me, phoned in. Just remember a lot of folks that's sick, and it would take a little while to go through everybody's prayer requests here tonight. But we know that God is able to do exceedingly abundantly above and beyond. Amen. Amen. And I know we're going to be blessed tonight. Sister Martha is going to be with us singing. And I know Brother Don is ready and shaking at the bit to share the Word of God with us. So let's just have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you today for your goodness and all that you do and all that you are. And Lord, we'll never cease to give you the honor and the praise. We know that you're able, God, to touch these needs and touch these ladies and gentlemen, Lord, that just need a mighty healing touch from you. So God, we'll just give them to you tonight and know, Lord, that God, all sickness is subject to you and your power. In Jesus' name we pray. And can we all say?
Amen.
Amen. And to all of our veterans, we just want to say Happy Veterans Day. Let's give you guys a great team. Love and appreciate y'all. Now, Sister Martha, let's sing.
I pledge allegiance.
Now let's welcome our teacher tonight, Brother Don Yates.
Good to be here tonight, gathered among God's people. A large crowd. Jesus said, "Where two or three was gathered together in His name, and He was in the midst." And so, I think everyone, possibly everyone, sat here tonight as I was born again. We brought Him with us. If He dwells in your heart and reigns in your life, when you come to church, you bring Him with you, and when you walk out those doors, you take Him with you. You don't leave Him here till next Sunday or next Wednesday, whenever you come back, but you take Him with you.
Amen. Amen.
I'm going to be ministering to that in Romans chapter 12. Good to be here, gathered among God's people.
Yes.
May be raining outside. We need a certain amount of it. Thank God for the rain.
Amen.
Chapter 12, beginning with verse 1. He said, "I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that ye present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service." Now, Paul's writing to this is the writer of this book here. And beseech means to implore. He's trying to get the people's attention that he's writing to here. Of course, the Bible's been written several hundred years now, so those people are dead and gone, but it's just as important to us today as it was for them. Beseech means to implore, to beg. I mean, he's trying to really get their attention.
Yeah.
And he's talking here, said, present your bodies a living sacrifice. You know, when they had in the Old Testament, when they were under the sacrificial system, they had to bring the best that they had out of their flock. They couldn't take just anything. They couldn't take the crippled, the lame, the blind. God wouldn't accept it. He wanted the best they had, and God said that not changed. He said He was the same yesterday, today, and forever. And He wants the best that we've got. You know, He don't want just the leftovers of our life. He wants us to give Him the best in the first part of our life. You know, we have to work a job and things like that. He told Adam he'd earn his living in the sweat of his face. So people still have to work for a living. But we need to... if it's at all possible, work our schedule around our church times when we're having church services. I used to work a job where I had to work three Sundays out of a month, work swing shift. Went from days to evenings to third shift. today's. I didn't like it very good. I worked it for about close to 7 years and ended up choosing another line of work. It just wasn't what I wanted to do all of my life. And besiege means to intrigue, to plead, or to beg. Paul's trying to get people's attention here. You know, we should be pleading with the lost.
That's right.
Trying to get their attention. Help them to see and realize their need of a Savior. God gave the best he had to offer. And he expects the best that we have to offer. He gave his only begotten son that we could have life and have it more abundantly. And without him, we would have been totally lost. Completely lost. That he gave the best that he had to offer. And God don't make people serve him. He said, I want you to present yourselves to me. He don't force people to serve him. And it's an individual's choice. We either accept him or reject him. And heaven's going to be full of people that accepted him. And it would seem like from Scripture that there's going to be more in hell that rejected him than there did that accepted him. And that's sad.
It is sad.
Because they have to walk over the blood of Jesus to get there.
Right.
He said that wide is the gate, straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth into life, and few there be that go in thereat. But wide is the gate that leadeth unto destruction, many there be which go in thereat. So, and if you, for the people that miss heaven, and there's only two places people are going to go, and if you go to hell, you're going to go as an intruder. The Bible says hell was created for the devil and his angels.
Right.
And there's going to be a lot of demon spirits there. And I don't think there was a third of Revelation talks about how his tail drew a third of the stars of heaven. It's talking about the devil. And so there was a third of the angels that were in heaven that followed him,
right,
was cast out with him. And there's no hope for their redemption. But for mankind, we have a hope. God sent his only son to die for us and pay our sin debt, that we could be redeemed back to him. Redeem means to buy back. And it cost God the best that he had. It cost him his only begotten son. And he laid his life down at Calvary, gave it freely. In one place he told him, he said, no man takes it from me. I lay it down. He said, I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it back. And he laid it down, and on that third and appointed morning, there wasn't enough demons in hell to keep him in that grave,
amen,
in that tomb.
Amen.
And when Mary Magdalene showed up at the tomb, she was the first one there.
Mm-hmm.
He had already come out of the tomb. The rock was thrown away. And it was a huge rock. And she looks in and she sees angels sitting there, one at the head and one at the foot, and they talk to her.
Right.
And then Peter and John shows up. And they see the empty tomb too, and the clothes folded in a certain place and laying there. But he came forth, and we serve a Savior that's living.
Amen.
He's alive and well.
Amen.
And he's going to live live forevermore.
Praise the Lord.
These three things God can't do. He can't lie, and he can't die, and he can't fail.
Amen. That's true.
And so there's, he's done paid the price at Calvary, and the next move is ours.
Yes.
You've probably heard the illustration says, kind of like somebody playing football. You know, they'll say the ball's in your hands.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Or basketball. And the ball's in your hands. Then what we do with it is up to each individual.
That's true.
And but he done paid the price for our redemption at Calvary. Beseech is an expression, it's kind of like a implore or maybe. Paul tried to get people's attention, and he wrote half, maybe a little better than half, of the New Testament. We know he wrote 13 books, and a lot of Bible scholars think he wrote Hebrews also, so that would be 14 out of the 27. And very intelligent man. And the Bible says he sat at the feet of Gamaliel. And Gamaliel was one of the high-ranking priests at the temple and taught him the scripture. If you go back to the early books of Acts, he was going about persecuting the church and thought he was doing God a service. And you know, it's sad that it seems like people that's real intelligent and they have good educations, that it's they have a harder time accepting God's plan of salvation than just common people do. You know, the chief priests, scribes, Pharisees, there was a few of them that believed in him. But most of them rejected him. And he's the only way to that man can go to heaven is through him by Jesus. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and no man cometh unto the Father but by me. You go by him or you don't go at all.
That's true.
And God had this ordained that Christ would die for the sins of humanity before humans were ever created. Mm-hmm. And I can prove it to you with scripture. Revelations 13 and 8. It talks about the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Before man was ever created, God had to sacrifice for him. You may say, well, why did God make man if he knew he was going to sin? Well, you can ask him one day when you get there.
Amen.
But of all of his creation, and he made a beautiful creation.
Yes.
But of all of his creation, man was his prized possession. the only I've ever seen him made. He makes some beautiful animals, and fish and birds and fowls are there. I mean, if you look at them, they're beautiful.
Yes.
But man was his supreme creation, created in his own image.
Amen.
And God was is a tripartite being. Godhead's made up of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost.
Right.
Of course, we're made up of spirit, soul, and body.
Mm-hmm.
So he, the scripture says, made us in his image. But, and he made us to serve him.
Yes.
Of course, I think most everybody sitting here tonight's read the Bible enough to know what happened.
Mm-hmm.
He made a beautiful garden and created Adam and Eve and put them in it to take care of it. And, sin entered the picture and they were driven out of the garden. And we've had to deal with sin for almost 6,000 years now.
That's right.
And we'll have to deal with it as long as we've got a breath in this body.
Mm-hmm.
But if we're a child of God, when the last breath leaves this body, we're going to be with Him.
Amen.
We're out of here.
Amen.
And, God wants some things of us and expects some things of us.
Yes.
He said that we present our bodies a living sacrifice.
Mm-hmm.
See, when they brought sacrifices to the temple, they couldn't bring the lame and the blind and the crippled. God said, bring me the best you've got.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
They had to go to their flocks and take the best sheep or the best bullock. Or the best goat, whatever they were bringing.
Mm-hmm.
And they had to bring the best they had for a sacrifice unto Him.
Sir.
He gave the best He had.
Yes.
His only begotten Son.
Amen.
And He wants the best out of us.
That's
He
right.
wants the first part of our life, not leftovers.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
He said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And all these things shall be added unto you.
Amen.
The things he's talking about was worldly possessions.
Mm-hmm.
Solomon was a young man when he ascended to the throne. God appeared to him in a dream and asked him what he would like to have. And he was honest with God. He said, I'm just a young man. And I don't know how to lead this great nation. And he asked for knowledge and wisdom. And that pleased God so much. He said, because you've asked this, I'll give you knowledge and wisdom that no man before you had or no man after you will have. And he said, because you've not ask for riches and wealth and the life of your enemies, I'm going to give you riches and wealth. Now normally kings, they would offer, you know, a few animals more than just a regular working person would, because they usually had more possessions. But if you go back to when Solomon was dedicating the temple that he had built to the Lord, he didn't offer a few. God had blessed the man.
Mm-hmm.
Because what he asked pleased him. He offered 120,000 sheep.
Mm-hmm.
And that wasn't counting the cattle and goats that he offered. But I mean, and God respected that. Respected his offering. But he wants us, he wanted us to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Mm-hmm. He wants our life.
Yes.
He don't care to give us wealth, but he wants the first part of our life. And if you'll accept him and give him the best you have to offer, and that's your life, he has no problem with giving you riches and wealth. You might say, well, why don't everybody get it? I guess some people couldn't handle it.
Yeah.
I heard them tell one time on TV that 60% of the people that won the lottery ended up filing bankruptcy. They couldn't handle it. God knows where we can, how much he can give us and what we can handle and what we can't.
That's right.
But he wants the best of our life. He started out here, set up the siege. That means to intrigue, to plead, or to beg. Paul's trying to get people's attention.
Yeah.
God tries to get people's attention.
That's right.
The Holy Spirit, through the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
He brings conviction upon people's heart. And the Holy Spirit, that one scripture said, Jesus said, no man can come to me except the Father which has sent me drawing.
Mm-hmm.
So the Holy Spirit has to draw us to the Father
mm-hmm.
before we can be born again. You know God's a merciful God.
Yes.
Paul said here, I beseech you first, brethren, in the mercies of God. If he hadn't been merciful, he would have burned us all when we were sinners. He's merciful. To the murderers, and thieves, and rapists. I mean, there's people in prison that's killed multiple people. They had one in California that had killed over 300 people, was in prison. And he kept appealing his case. Government had spent over $5 million on his court costs. A story one time, a true story. A minister went to the hospital and started witnessing to a man who was really sick, probably on his what we'd call his deathbed. And he was talking to him about salvation. And he looked at the minister and said, I was a hitman, and I've killed 23 people that did me no harm. So do you mean to tell me that God is willing to forgive me of that? And the preacher witnessed to him and ministered to him, told him, yes, God's willing to forgive you of that. Now, I don't know whether the man received his salvation or not, but the minister did his job. He told him about Jesus and his love and how he died for him. And that's all God requires of us. He told, I believe it was Ezekiel, he said, Son of man, I call you to be a watchman of the house of Israel. And if you don't warn the wicked and he dies in his sins, then his blood I will pour at your hands. But if you warn him and he don't listen to your warning, then thou hast delivered thy soul. So So it's important that we witness to people and tell them about Jesus. We can't save them. We can't make them receptive. But we have to witness to them and do our part and pray that the Holy Spirit will be a drawing them to Jesus.
That's right.
Jesus said, no man can come to me except my Father, which has sent me, draw him.
Right.
So the Holy Spirit has to be drawing people before they can get saved.
Mm-hmm.
But the Holy Spirit's faithful in doing his job. We have to be faithful in doing our part.
Mm-hmm.
And our part is witnessing to them and showing them the love of Christ and telling them about a Savior that loved them and died for them. He says, present our bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. God don't ask us of nothing that we can't do or that's unreasonable. As humans, there's things we can't do. We're finite. He's infinite. He can't lie, he can't die, he can't fail. And he's all powerful. And God can do anything he wants to do. But he don't force salvation on anyone. We're to present it to people, and they either accepted or rejected it. And every one of us is sitting here tonight. It was presented to us sometime in the past. And I don't know everyone's heart, but for all of those that are here tonight or they're saved and born again, we had to accept it when it was presented to us.
Mm-hmm.
Salvation's a gift of God.
Yes.
And you either receive it or you reject it and push him away.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
And that's a dangerous thing when people reject it.
Yes.
So you can't be saved unless the Holy Spirit is drawing you. And, you know, after a while, God might say, it's enough. They don't want to hear it. They don't want to receive it. But he's very merciful. He may call you once. He may call you 1,000 times. He said, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. The New Testament was written in Greek. Greek word for conformed here is a word that means to be similar or identical. God don't want us to look like the world. He said, be not conformed to the world. He wants us to be conformed to the image of his Son. But he said, be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. And you know, when a person is born again, the Holy Spirit has to be drawing a person.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to make a willful decision. When he's drawing you, the Holy Spirit, and he draws you with cords of love.
Mm-hmm.
But when he's drawing you, you only have two options. You're going to receive him or reject him. It's a dangerous thing to reject him. But God is very merciful. He may call you many times. The Greek word for conformed here, I'm not even going to try to pronounce it, but it means to conform to another's example. He don't want us to be conformed to the world's example. He don't want us to look like the world. He don't want us to act like the world. He don't want us to live like the world. Fact is, in one place he said, come ye out from among the world, be ye separate, and I will receive you, and ye shall be my sons and daughters.
That's right.
So he's calling us out of the world. But when he calls, we, and God is very loving, he don't force people to serve him. The Holy Spirit will lovingly bring conviction upon people's heart and draw them to Jesus. But then they have a decision to make. They either accept him or reject him. When he called me when I was 21 years, I made the right decision. 21 years old. And I've been following him ever since. I've failed him in ways. But he still loved me and dealt with me. And it's been sweet. Nothing's been no sweeter in my life.
Amen.
I guess when he saved me, he radically saved me. When I got saved, I wanted to tell everybody about Jesus.
Hallelujah.
I was working over here at Inca. You don't know where it's at, up on 160. It's closed down now. When I worked there, it was a big factory. I worked over 2,000 people. And I take my Bible with me to work. And the job I was doing, occasionally I had some free time. And I'd sit and read the Bible. The other guys would bring newspapers or books, whatever they wanted to read, and read them. But I'd sit and read my Bible.
Amen.
And Scripture tells us to hunger and thirst after his righteousness.
Sure.
I guess when he saved me, he radically saved me. I wanted to know more about him.
Mm-hmm.
And I've read the Bible for about 60 years now. And I'm not saying that bragging. But what goes in is all that can come out. If you don't put it in, then you're not going to have nothing to come out and help people.
That's true. Amen.
One scripture said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. First thing God wants us to do is seek him and his righteousness. He don't care to give us earthly possessions. If he does and blesses us in that way, it's wonderful. But he wants us to use them for his glory. We're not going to take none of it with us.
That's right.
If you see a widow in need or a hungry child, love them. Do something for them, for their need. And God will bless you for it. I'm going to live an example of that. I'm going to read a few scriptures here, and then we'll get back in the... Matthew 15, verse 11 and 16 through 20. This was Jesus speaking. Not that which goeth into the mouth defileth the man, but that which cometh out of the mouth, this defileth the man. And then in verse 15, Peter said unto him, declaring this is parable. Jesus said, are you also yet without understanding? Do you not yet understand that whatso entereth in at the mouth goeth into the belly and is cast down into the draught? That's thou hast. But those things which proceed out of the mouth comes forth from the heart, and they defile the man. For out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witness, blasphemies. These are the things which defile a man, but to eat with unwashed hands defileth not a man. And, you know, the Pharisees were really strict. They thought it was a sin if you eat something that hadn't washed your hands. And they may have had a reason for doing that, but God don't want us to be hard-hearted. Under the laws of the temple, they were to wash and do different things when they offered these sacrifices. But, you know, washing the world is just dirt off of you. If you've been out working your garden, and your hands is dirty. Yeah, you need to wash your hands before you eat. That don't make you more holy or more righteous. And the Pharisees had I've got it wrote down here. Had 613 laws. There's a lot of laws in the Bible, but some of them made up themselves, you know. 365 of them were negative, one for every day of the week. 248 were affirmative. But they may have had good intentions, but people can get carried away with their own things. Now God wants us to eat healthy. He wants us to rest properly. But you can rest properly and eat healthy and still go to hell if you don't accept Him as your Savior. That's just part of it. And I've got some more scriptures written down here. 1 Corinthians 6, 19 and 20. What? Know ye not that your body is a temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which you have of God, and you're not your own? If you're bought with a price, therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. And the Holy Spirit draws us to Jesus, and we make Him Lord of our life. We were bought with a price. It cost Jesus His life, His blood. God gave the best He had to offer. He expect no less from us. He wants us to give the best that we have to offer. Amen. And He wants our lives. The rest of our life. Mm-hmm. Not me in today and out tomorrow and in next week. meeting out a month later. He wants you to be steadfast.
You know, that decision you make to follow Jesus isn't a one-time decision. It's a daily decision that you choose to pick up your cross every morning.
That's right.
I believe one scripture says, pick up your cross daily,
daily.
And follow me.
Yeah.
You know, I try to practice it all the time. It may be a few days I forget. When I open my eyes, I like to say, good morning, Father God. Good morning, King Jesus. Good morning, Holy Spirit.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for sparing my life another night.
Amen.
Okay, 2 Corinthians 6, 14 through 18. Be ye not unequally yoked together with unbelievers, for what fellowship hath righteousness with unrighteousness? And what communion hath light with darkness? Now he's speaking to believers here. And he said, don't be unequally yoked. This scripture in the Old Testament says you're not to, wasn't to plow an oxen and a donkey together. Two completely different animals. An oxen was much stronger. He couldn't, the donkey couldn't do his part of the work if he tried.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
So, water and oil don't mix. Sin and righteousness don't mix. He said not to be unequally yoked together with unbelievers. Now, if you've married and didn't know that scripture was in there, and you're a child of God and your companion's a sinner, he didn't say leave her or leave him. You're to set an example before them, pray for them, and try to win them to the Lord. And what concord hath Christ with Belial? Or what part he that believeth with an infidel? God tries to spare people. Trouble. Mm-hmm. When you marry a Christian person, marries a sinner, there's one. God's pulling the Christian one way and the devil's pulling the sinner another way.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And all it does is cause confusion and problems.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I wanted a believer to marry a believer.
Mm-hmm.
If two sinners marry, hopefully they'll both give their heart to the Lord and turn to Him during their lifetime. And what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For you're the temple of the living God, and God has said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. God lives in us, in our heart.
Amen.
And He wants to work through us.
Yes.
To reach out to the lost and to reach out to other people.
Amen.
He wants us to be vessels made for the Master's use.
Mm-hmm.
Wherefore, come ye out from among them, and be ye separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you. So, God expects His people to, when they give their life to Him, to walk away from their sinful past.
Mm-hmm.
He said, come out from among them and touch not the unclean thing.
Mm-hmm.
Now, He didn't say we would shun sinners.
Mm-hmm.
We're to live a life before them. That God hopes when they see the life we're living, that it will make them desire to have what we've got.
That's right.
That's what God's will is for our life.
Mm-hmm.
Sinners will see us and desire to have what we've got.
Mm-hmm.
We've got hope. The Bible says they have no hope.
That's right.
Until they turn to Christ.
Amen.
They may have a lot of the world's wealth, but it won't bring happiness.
Mm-hmm. No.
And it won't get them to heaven.
No.
You can't buy your way in. The only ones going to be in heaven is those that have been born and bought with the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
Lived holy lives before Him. So the last breath leaves their body. You can't serve Him 2 years or 5 years, walk away from Him and expect to go to heaven. Now, I realize there's teachings in the world that says what's saved, always saved. But people can walk away. The Bible several times mentioned backsliders. One scripture said the backslider in heart will be filled with his own ways. God wouldn't have said people would backslide if they couldn't backslide.
That's right.
So, another scripture says work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. I've got to work mine out. You've got to work yours out. But we're both going the same way if we go to heaven.
Amen.
And that's through the shed blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And His atoning work at Calvary.
Amen. Amen.
Verse 2, be not conformed. I'm back in Romans 12. Be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. I wrote, jotted a few things down here. God don't want us to look like the world. He don't want us to act like the world. He said, be not conformed to the world. And just from the Greek word, suschematizo, it means to conform to another's example. He went on to say, be you transformed by the renewing of your mind. And that's what happens when a person's saved.
That's right.
God renews their mind and their heart. There's a change takes place. The word transformed is metamorpho. Have you ever heard of metamorphosis?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's what takes place with the butterfly.
Yeah.
Some moth or something lays an egg in a cocoon and wraps it up in there.
Mm-hmm.
And it'll take a few weeks. When that, and it'll start out, it'll just be an ugly worm in there. But when it cuts out of there, if you've ever, and I've seen a lot of them, I was raised out in the country.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
And there's a metamorphosis takes place.
Yes,
that metamorpho, that's where we get the English word metamorphosis. There's a change takes place in that cocoon. It just starts out as an egg and grows into a worm.
That's right.
And you know the worm itself's not too pretty. But when it grows into that beautiful butterfly and moth and cuts its way out,
mm-hmm.
I mean, there's some of them absolutely beautiful.
Beautiful.
As pretty as anything you've ever seen.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's the way God, when He saves us, He's a metamorphosis takes place in our life.
That's right.
We no longer go to the places we used to go and do the things we used to do and talk the things we used to talk. We're a new creation, a new preacher in Christ.
Amen.
And and that's what transform means, metamorphosis.
That's right.
And when we're saved, notice what he said. He said, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. God changes your thoughts when you're saved. You don't go the places you used to go. You don't do the things you used to do. You don't treat people the way you used to treat them. Said that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God.
Amen.
For I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly according as God has dealt to every man the measure of faith. Amen. You know, you can't be saved without faith.
That's right.
Scripture says he that comes to him must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of the ones that we seek him. And it says without faith, I believe it's Hebrews 11:6, that it's impossible, without faith, it's impossible to please God.
That's true.
So we have to come to him in faith, and we have to believe his word.
Amen.
And what it says.
Mm-hmm.
And Jesus told him, he said, you must be born again. That's the one condition for every sinner on earth to go to heaven.
Yes.
They have to be bought and born by the blood of Jesus.
That's right.
Through the power of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit does the drawing and brings conviction on their heart.
Mm-hmm.
But it's the blood of Jesus that does the cleansing.
Mm-hmm.
Cleanses from all sin and unrighteousness.
That's true. Mm-hmm.
We don't need to get high-minded or lifted up. It's all equal ground at the foot of Calvary. Don't matter where you're poor or rich, well-known or unknown. We all have to come the same way. Through Christ's atoning sacrifice at Calvary. You know, there's no room for people in God's kingdom to get puffed up. He said, do not think more highly of yourself than you ought to.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right.
The Bible tells us to stay humble and meek. God can use a humble person. Let me talk to you about meek in a minute. It don't mean that when he's talking about a person being meek, to let the devil walk all over you. But what he's talking about is strength under control.
Right.
It's like a wild horse. He's perfect, but he's useless. When you catch him and tame him and break him,
right.
He still has the same amount of strength.
That's good.
But you've got his strength under control.
That's right.
And then it's good. I plowed some of them.
Mm-hmm.
You can raise a good garden and good crops with them. We never had a tractor, and I grew it up. We did all the plowing with the horse. And it wasn't too bad till you hit a rock and that plow handle jumped up and kicked in your ribs.
Ouch. Yeah.
That's the worst part of it.
Oh, yeah.
But first, we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office. So we being many are one body in Christ, and every one members one of another. So we have no right to get puffed up at nobody, our brothers and sisters. Mm-hmm. At Calvary, it's all, we all came the same way.
Amen.
A sinner needing grace.
Amen.
God's grace and mercy.
Amen.
And humbleness don't mean that you're weak. But it's like that horse I was just talking about. A wild horse is useless to me. But when you tame him and break him, you get a lot of good out of him. You raise your good garden.
Sure.
You can saddle him up. And you need to go somewhere before that, especially when they didn't have cars and automobiles. You had to ride one sometimes.
It's
either that or walk. But he said here in verse 3, not to think of ourselves more highly than we ought to think. Mm-hmm. We're all equal ground, equal footing for the Calvary.
Yes, we are.
We're all sinners, and we're saved by grace. And I have no right to think I'm better than anyone else in here, or vice versa.
That's true.
But if we go to heaven, we're all one because we've been born and bought with the blood of Jesus. That's what you have to do to get there.
That's right.
Those that reject him have no hope.
That's true.
In one scripture, the Bible talks about those that have no hope.
That's right.
If they leave this world lost, there's no hope for them.
It's true.
It's sad, but there's not. Mm-hmm. And they have, sinners have to walk over the blood of Jesus to go to hell.
It's true.
Mm-hmm. One scripture talks about, I believe it's in Hebrews 10th chapter, about those that have trod upon the blood of Jesus. Instead of how much source of punishment suppose you shall he be thought worthy, thus trod under foot the blood of Jesus, and counted the blood of the covenant wherewith he was an unholy thing, that's the sinner, and done despite unto the spirit of grace. So we all come from level ground, same ground to Calvary. The one condition for any human being on earth is what Jesus told Nicodemus in the third chapter of St. John. He said, you must be born again. And that's John 3, verses 3 and 5, I believe. And you know, he said God dealt to every man a measure of faith. Everybody believes in something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the atheists, they claim they don't believe there's no God, but they believe in something.
Yes, they did.
Yeah. Yeah.
But the Bible says the God of this world is blinded. The minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them.
That's right.
So, God has to, the Holy Spirit has to be bring conviction on a person's heart and draw them to Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people will go to the altar when he's drawing, and others hang on to it and rip it to their knuckles as white. Stand there and walk out lost. But he's merciful. He may draw them many times.
That's right.
But I'm so thankful that I hear these calls, they call me time to close out. Hope the lesson's been a blessing to you, that I said something to be a help to you. Remember what Jesus told Nicodemus in John chapter 3. He said, you must be born again. That's the one condition for a lost person, any lost person, to go to heaven. You have to be born again.
That's right. Amen.
You have to have been washed with the blood of Jesus. He has to cleanse your heart, your mind, start you out on a new road, a new walk with Him. And you've got to read His word and pray and should be a witness and working for Him to live a holy life before here on earth. And live for Him till the last breath is your body. And then we're going to be with Him one day. To reign with Him for eternity. Scripture says, I haven't seen, ear hasn't heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man what God has prepared for them that love Him.
Amen.
We don't know what He's got waiting on us.
That's right.
But I'm sure looking forward to seeing Him.
Me too. It is.
And it may be a lot closer than what you realize.
Sure.
Okay. Brother Kip can give you the information. He shared it with me, and I watched a fellow doing teaching. He's a Jewish man. Mm-hmm. I assume he's a Christian with the way he's talking. Mm-hmm. But he goes back to Adam, 4004 B.C. Mm-hmm. And he uses Genesis 1:1, in the beginning God created the heaven and earth. The guy talked for an hour and 5 minutes in Genesis 1:1.
Wow.
And he knew Hebrew. He could break it all down to a child could understand it. Mm-hmm. And all the time he's talking, there's a pencil and fingers, part of a man's hands and arm, a drawing, graphs and pictures and stuff while he's talking. But I don't have time to tell you all of it. It's time to close out. But he said God had allotted man 6,000 years. And when he gets through, the 6,000 year date was 2030. And the 7 at 6, and Peter, 2 Peter, it says one day is with the Lord is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. He said God's allotted man 6 days. The seventh day is the millennium, the 1,000-year reign of Christ. He broke it down to a child could understand.
Wow.
And but he said 2030 is the end of the 6,000 years. And he said 7 years of tribulation, subtract 7 from that, and you come up with 2023. And he said, Jesus can come back any time between now and 2023. He said, I'm not putting a day or an hour, but no man knows that. But said he can come back any time between now and 2023. And after seeing what's happened in our nation in the last 4 years, I'm beginning to think that way myself.
Yes.
Yes.
But thank God for His word tonight. I love Him. Hope it's been a blessing to your heart.
Amen.
And Brother Kemp, would you like to close us out in prayer?
Father, we thank you for the word. We thank you, God, for this night. Lord, we thank you that we know for sure that there is only one way to go to heaven, and that's through your Son. Mm-hmm. We thank you, Lord God, for your teaching us and calming us and restoring peace to us. Because, Father, we know that no matter what's going on in the world, you've got your children covered.
Yes.
We appreciate that, Lord. Now, Lord, take this word and let it be an encouragement to us, a strengthen to us, and that we may help bring others into the kingdom.
Yes.
as we go our own separate ways, God, into our own homes, our own place, go with us, protect us, and keep us safe until you bring us safely together again, or until we meet again in heaven. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.